Okay, here we go. Stand by. 3, 2, 1, action.
Assume nothing.
Rash, bald-faced blasphemy.
Question everything.
I find it extremely hard to imagine.
Open your eyes.
It is quite all right to be an atheist.
The fastest growing group of people in the country has been measured as being those who have no belief or who are atheists.
You don't have to be apologetic or quiet about it.
Challenge the opposition.
You see religion on 100 fronts losing the argument.
And start thinking. This is The Thinking Atheist Worldwide.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by EvolveFish.com, the original heathen atheist humanist freethinker merchandiser. A lot of imitators out there, a lot of emulators out there. EvolveFish was first. They started like 22 years ago. And finally, after years and years and years of me trying to find ways to get the Thinking Atheist mugs available online, which I couldn't do with my current fulfillment house, I've partnered up with EvolveFish, and they are making the Thinking Atheist mugs available online. It's awesome. They've got the TTA icon on one side, the thinking person icon, and the other side simply says, start thinking. The word atheist appears nowhere on there. It's just a conversation starter. So for those who've been saying, when will you have the mugs at places other than the conventions, they are now available. You can go to evolvefish.com, and then you'll see a tab that says partners, and the Thinking Atheist store is right there. So thanks for supporting the show, and a huge thanks out to my new partners, the folks at evolvefish.com. At the top of Evolve Fish's website right now is the popular I Am Charlie slogan, along with the illustration of a robed figure slicing a pencil with a machete or sword. Of course, the illustration refers to Charlie Hebdo, the focus of our broadcast tonight. Forgive the delay in getting to this show. We started late in the month with the 200th broadcast, and then I've been ill, so I'm just now getting back in the game. But it's a subject we must talk about. Charlie Hebdo is a French satirical magazine published weekly that was first published under that name in 1970. It actually started in another form 10 years earlier and was periodically banned for inflammatory content. I mean, from the get-go, they were definitely on the cutting edge and pushing envelopes. The tactic they came up with for sidestepping the ban on their magazine was to change the name from, I'm going to hopefully say this right, Harakiri to Charlie Hebdo, named after a monthly comic called Charlie, and also apparently is an inside joke regarding the late French President Charles de Gaulle. In publication off and on over the last decades, Charlie Hebdo has featured cartoons, jokes, articles that take on the extreme right-wing parties of French politics, takes on religion, specifically, mostly anyway, Catholicism, Islam, and Judaism, and more. In 2007, the Grand Mosque of Paris filed a lawsuit against Charlie Hebdo for violations against their religious freedoms, or essentially attacking them. They specifically targeted several cartoons, one of which featured a depiction of the Prophet Muhammad carrying a bomb on his turban. The newspaper had a history of depicting and lampooning Muhammad on its cover and within its pages, at one point prompting French President Jacques Chirac to warn about, quote, overt provocations which could, quote, inflame passions. So even the French president was nervous. The charges were ultimately dismissed by the court, reasoning the cartoons in question were not an attack on the religion of Islam, but Muslim terrorists and a commentary on religious fundamentalism. On the 2nd of November 2011, the offices of Charlie Hebdo were firebombed, and its website was hacked. This is one day, by the way, before the magazine was to publish a cover of Muhammad with the caption, 100 lashes of the whip if you don't die laughing. Fast forward to January 7th, 2015, just a few weeks ago. Two gunmen forced their way into the Paris headquarters of Charlie Hebdo. They barged into an editorial meeting during lunchtime, separated the men and the women, and called out the names of the employees they intended to kill. The physician who treated the survivors described it as a precision execution. 12 people were executed that day, including a police officer who was outside the building and was himself reported to be a Muslim. During the attack, the gunman shouted, "God is great and the Prophet is avenged." The men were discovered to be French Muslim brothers, ultimately killed in a standoff with police 2 days later. 4 million people across the nation marched in a historic display of defiance and solidarity with the victims. Signs in their hands and posters all across social media bore the words, "Je suis Charlie," or "I am Charlie." I hope I said that correctly in the French. Forgive me. "Je suis Charlie." Did I say it right? The survivors who work for Charlie Hebdo declared they would not be silenced, printing an illustration of the Prophet Muhammad on its very next issue, which was published the very next week. And instead of the usual 45,000 to 60,000 copies of the magazine in circulation, over 7 million copies were printed and distributed. Immediately, the conversation turned to the Islamic murderers, those who executed in the name of God, and how responsible Islam is for the chaos caused in its name. USA Today published an article just 4 days ago called "New Hebdo Cover Continues to Roil the Muslim World." Segments of the article said this: "In Karachi, Pakistan, Friday, encounters between police and protesters gathered in front of the French embassy saw 4 shot, including 2 journalists. Pakistani lawmakers called the Hebdo cartoons hate speech. A parliamentary resolution noted that, quote, freedom of expression should not be used as a means to attack or hurt public sentiments and religious beliefs, unquote. In the West African nation of Niger, the president said at least 10 people have been killed after violent protests broke out against the latest cartoon depicting Muhammad in the French publication. He said that 5 deaths were reported after demonstrations in the capital of Niamey on Saturday. The victims were inside churches and bars that were set ablaze, he said. On Friday, at least 5 people were killed in the town of Zinder after prayer services there. Iranian judicial authorities on Saturday banned a daily newspaper for publishing a front-page headline that allegedly indicated support for Charlie Hebdo. The chief editor of Today's People told the semi-official Tasnim news agency that his paper had been ordered closed. The paper's Tuesday edition featured a front-page article with a headline that quoted filmmaker and activist George Clooney as saying, "I am Charlie Hebdo." However, the accompanying article did not actually express support for Clooney's statement nor for the magazine itself. The Iranian government has publicly condemned both the attack on Charlie Hebdo and the magazine itself, calling the continued publishing of Muhammad caricatures, quote, provocative and an insult to Islam. On January the 12th, 10 days ago, the Huffington Post published a story titled, "Think Muslims Haven't Condemned the Charlie Hebdo Attack? Think Again." And they listed examples. The Grand Mosque of Paris, mentioned earlier in this monologue, one of the many organizations that issued a statement after the shooting saying its community was shocked and horrified. Quote, "We strongly condemn these kinds of acts, and we expect the authorities to take the most appropriate measures. Our community is stunned by what just happened. It's a whole section of our democracy that is seriously affected. This is a deafening declaration of war. Times have changed. And we are now entering a new era of confrontation." The Union of Islamic Organizations in France said, "The UOIF condemns in the strongest terms this criminal attack and these horrible murders. The UOIF expresses its deepest condolences to the families and all the employees of Charlie Weekly." In the aftermath, we see the acts of religious extremists who respond to the stroke of a pen with the firing of a gun. And we here have to figure out how to identify the problem and then how to solve it. We have several special guests coming up on the broadcast. In just a few minutes, I'm going to be talking with Michael DeDora. He's the director of the Center for Inquiry's Office of Public Policy and the organization's rep to the UN. Brian Dalton of the Mr. Deity series. He posted a very provocative video a few days ago. I've asked him to join us for a few minutes on the radio. I've got Ali Rizvi and Faisal Saeed Al-Muttar coming up. First, I want to start with a short conversation with a satirist who actually knew the people in the offices of Charlie Hebdo that day. He is a friend. His name is Vince DePorter. Vince, how you doing, man?
I'm doing great, Seth.
I want to make sure I'm sort of transparent with everyone. The reason Vince and I sort of had this dialogue is because we're friends. We've been collaborating on a project. He's the illustrator for my next book, which comes out in the spring, and I'll have details on that next month. This isn't about that. But Vincent is a hugely talented artist, and he's sort of wired in with many artists like those who worked at Charlie Hebdo and whatnot. And we were talking about it, and Vince, you knew these people personally, is that correct?
Yes, the artists especially. They were actually my friends. Not that we hung out all the time, but they started to help me with my career when I lived in Paris.
So did you follow their work? Did you follow the very controversial things they were posting over there? And what was your take on all that as an artist?
Well, I was very proud, of course. What really made me happy was that they were the only magazine to reproduce that Mohammed cartoon with the bomb on his head that put everybody up in up in arms about it. So the editor-in-chief and the artist, they were courageous enough to put this out, and no other magazine or newspaper did.
How did that make you feel? I mean, you're watching the media here in the United States, and they're all sitting on their hands. Do you think they did it out of deference because they respect religion, or do you think they were terrified that somebody was going to show up and do what happened at Charlie Hebdo at their own office? I mean, what's your take?
My take is that it's fear, and only fear. They fear what happened. Well, we saw what happened to Charlie Hebdo, but that's what the terrorists count on. I mean, the extremists, they count on everybody shutting up and being scared, and they managed that very well.
Have you ever drawn anything sort of controversial in your own life, in your own circle? I mean, I know you're a non-believer. I know you're a critic of religion. You've done mostly like mainstream work, though. I know you draw for SpongeBob.
Yes.
You've drawn. Give me your resume real quick. I'm just want everybody to know kind of what you're about and what you've been doing over your career.
Well, I started my career in Belgium and then in France, in Paris. I have had my own series in France. Or rather in a Belgian magazine called Spirou. And I worked with them for years. And it was a dream since I was a little kid. In fact, I told my dad when I was 5 years old that I wanted to be a writer cartoonist. So I was pretty much set in my ways. I didn't have much doubt about what I was going to do, even though on the way I did music, stand-up comedy and stuff like that. So I had my own series in France. It was okay. I mean, it paid the bills for a while, and then it kind of tapered off. And I started working for DC Comics, specifically doing Batman and Superman licensing work. From then I jumped on to Scooby-Doo, and I did Scooby-Doo for 16 years. I was even the cover artist for Scooby-Doo for a whole year. And I loved it. I loved it. At the same time, I presented my portfolio to Nickelodeon Magazine, to Chris Duffy, which is an amazing editor. He's actually my favorite editor of all times. We started the Rugrats together. I also did Cat Dog, Ed, and Eddie. That was more for DC Comics. And it's while I was doing the Rugrats that they called me in for SpongeBob 15 years ago. And there you go. Since then, I've been a SpongeBob guy.
Oh, you know, when I was a believer, SpongeBob was controversial. You know, after all, he's gay. That's what they used to tell us, right? This is part of the gay, quote unquote, agenda to corrupt our youth. You've heard that argument, I'm sure, a few times.
Yes. Actually, it comes from something that actually happened. For the first years, it wasn't working as we hoped for, but we weren't surprised because in that era, it was mainly educational cartoons like Blue's Clues and stuff like that. So we came in a little bit like silly, like in my times where you had Bugs Bunny and stuff like that that were just silly. So it wasn't really liked at first. And then the gay community used it in a parade, I think, if I remember well. used SpongeBob since he was asexual, really. But there are a few episodes that made him play like the mom or the you know, the housewife. So they took him a little bit to heart and used him as a mascot, and that really started the fire. And it was good, you know, it was good. It was actually a very good publicity, even though, to be totally official, SpongeBob is not gay.
It's amazing the stuff people get themselves in a twist over. And, you know, this brings us back to why we're speaking in the first place. We're talking about Islamist, radical Islamist. I mean, I've seen the people. They're rioting, they're burning, they're rending their garments, they're shouting, they're screaming, they're freaking because of a cartoon. It's insane, Vince.
It's crazy. And, of course, I'm not too quiet about it. If you look at my Facebook, I'm pretty open about what I think about all this. And I would definitely have been with my colleagues at Charlie Hebdo drawing stuff like that too. It's very, very difficult to not go after the terrorists, because I think that it's the right thing to do. I mean, I'm surprised that not everybody is printing out those comics and giving a point, but no, everybody is scared of this bunch, you know, a handful of a bunch of crazy zealots, and that's it. Crazy. I mean, yeah.
I guess, you know, watching social media, the American social media scene seems to be taking up where the American media has not. You know, I mean, NBC, ABC, Fox, CNN, all those people aren't, out of respect. They are, this is, you know, how they couch it. They're not going to publish, or they've even blurred some parts out. But if you go to social media pages, people are posting, reposting, they're getting the Charlie Hebdo and caricatures of Muhammad. Of course, this brings us back to Draw Muhammad Day, which was started years ago. And it seems to be that, you know, these social media warriors, people are saying, look, if the media won't do it, we'll do it personally. There seems to be sort of a groundswell. Have you seen some of that?
Oh, yes, yes. In fact, you probably have seen the Charlie Hebdo didn't skip a beat. The next week, they had the magazine come out with the front cover, a drawing of Mohammed holding the sign, Je suis Charlie. And on top of it, saying everything is forgiven. I mean, if you want to stab a knife into the eyes of these terrorists, Charlie Hebdo did that very well. But you're right. On the social media, people are outraged. And people are outraged at the news, at the American media, because they're saying nothing. They call it being respectful, but I'm sorry, that's a synonym for fear, and that's all it is, you know?
You and I are just talking over coffee, and I was to say, do you think this is an Islam problem, or do you think these extremists don't represent true Islam? I mean, have you gone there, and do you want to go
there? Oh, yeah. I've written about that, actually. It's a good question, because I do believe that people that are like in ISIS, for example, are really bloodthirsty killers, and they would find any excuse to kill. I think that in their very case, they use Islam and the Quran as an excuse. So there's two things I'd like to say about that. One is that I don't believe these people are really religiously pushed, but I think they use it as an excuse, and I think they're just cold-blooded killers that take a lot of pleasure in beheading people and have an excuse to do so. And the second thing is they have an excuse to do so, which means that they have the Quran that is followed by the letter. And by the way, I've posted on my Facebook, but a movie that was made about the moderate Muslims, where they're at a meeting and they admit that they agree with the Allah's law. They have to, or else they're going to be beheaded themselves. A Muslim has to believe in Allah's law and the Quran, which means you have to behead or stone gays and people who defect. So they do have a basis to their madness, but I am convinced that they are totally mad and that they are just bloodthirsty. And if it wasn't the Quran, it would be something else.
Not Muslims as a blanket, but the ones who are the violent people on the front lines. I mean, it has to be said, there are many people who are Muslims who practice their faith in a peaceful way. I think they're much like casual Christians. They and sort of ignore the more inconvenient parts of a very ugly holy book, and they just make it sort of a cultural belief in some way. Then there are those who are under the thumb or under the fist of a very radical Islamic government, and they truly do feel this is an affront to humanity and they support free speech. But if they were to go out and say so publicly, they and their spouse and their children and their grandparents and everybody they know could be in physical danger. It's a hugely complex problem, huh?
Yes. The fact is that they have a thing. I forget what it's called now. I don't have the name in hand, but they have a special word for lying to protect their faith. They will lie to say that it's not true, that they're violent, etc. But I do have something to say about the very moderate, you know, laissez-faire kind of people. They are peaceful and they pose no danger. But if you ask the most moderate and peaceful Muslim if he believes that the Quran is right about punishment for gays, he will have to say yes. There's no doubt about it. In other words, when it comes to the end of it, they either defect or they support the beheadings, etc.
At the very least, they're giving the Quran lip service. You know, the apostate must be killed. I mean, if you take the scripture literally, what was the line that said, if you have a problem with your religion's fundamentalists, then you probably have a problem with your religion's fundamentals. And the problem isn't that people have misinterpreted the Quran. The problem is the Quran. Right.
Exactly. It's the final point. It's the Quran that is the problem, especially when it's followed like the terrorists do. So that is a problem. In fact, if the Christians followed the Old Testament, it would be in the same mess with Christians. And actually, we were. The Muslims are doing what Christians did in the 13th century. That's, you know, it is clear that they're taking their turn here. But we can't let them do it.
It's funny, you know, Faisal, who's coming up in just a little bit in the broadcast, has said that many times. I think I'm paraphrasing Faisal, so you know, correct me when you come on the radio, but he said something like, Islam today is like the Christianity of the 11th century or the 12th century. Right. You know, I mean, it's the Inquisition, it's the Crusades, it's the burning of the witches. It's, you know, it is a very literal interpretation of a very primitive and barbaric text and religion. Before I let you go here, Vince, I want to talk about the power of artistry and expression in that way, in the arena of ideas. And people can put pen to paper, they can write a blog. There is something about the work of artists, whether it's Charlie Hebdo or someone else, maybe your own work, that can really ignite the imagination and further the conversation. Do you want to speak about this power of the artist in the conversation here?
Yes, I think that satire especially is a form of humor that, you know, pokes everybody in the eye. I did one story, only one for Mad Magazine, but I was a big fan and I'm still a big fan of Mad Magazine. And look at what they did with movies or TV shows. They would make fun of it. But the truth is, we all knew that a lot of it was true, was right on point.
So, all truth lies in jest, that kind of thing, huh?
Exactly. Yeah. So, of course, when it comes to religion or politics, for that matter, satire hurts. It's meant to make people laugh. And believe me, I've laughed my head off at Charlie Hebdo at things I would go after saying, you know, like, oh, my God, no, they didn't go there.
I can't believe they printed this.
So satire is meant to shuffle people's nice ironed clothes. You know,
blow some fresh air through the cobwebs to make people squirm a little bit in their seats. Huh?
Yeah. I think that the Charlie Hebdo story, actually what happened is that it made people realize that we have to fight for freedom of speech. And unfortunately, we now have to fight for humor, which is true, is meant to, you know, kick the mud. But unfortunately, if nobody says anything, we're just going to keep on being afraid and, you know, to go outside and, you know, to say what we think.
I saw an interview with a radical Islamist. I don't know the name of the interview. It was done in Germany. It was done in German with subtitles. And the Islamist who he was interviewing actually said something to the effect of, oh, the beheadings will continue. The executions will continue. Fear is a powerful motivator kind of thing. We need people. We want people to be afraid because when they're afraid, we win. And I think that's a powerful sort of a message for the rest of us that, you know, we cannot live our lives in fear or else they win.
That's right. In fact, it's interesting to see that he actually said exactly what we accuse him of. you know?
Yeah. Vincent, thank you so much for your perspective on this. I wish you the best in your endeavors. And thanks for sharing your perspective as an artist on the broadcast today. And it's greatly appreciated, my friend.
Well, thank you very much. And thank you for what you're doing. You know that you make me laugh a lot, too. So
sometimes even on purpose. Huh?
Yeah, sometimes right. On purpose. Yeah, so
do Take I. care of yourself, Vince. We'll talk to you soon.
Thank you, Seth. Okay, have a good one. Bye.
I've been watching the dialogue in the chat room as they debate what is and isn't hate speech. What is and isn't hate speech? And should hate speech be protected? So I looked up online the dictionary.com definition of hate speech. Speech that attacks, threatens, or insults a person or group on the basis of national origin, ethnicity, color, religion, gender, gender identity, sexual orientation, or disability. So if you are attacking, threatening, or insulting a religion, are you guilty? Are we guilty? Am I guilty of hate speech? In the context of ridiculing ridiculous beliefs, I don't think it's hate speech. I don't think the brand of hate speech is applicable there. In fact, quite often I believe that is used as a shield to insulate ridiculous ideas from criticism. But I'd be curious to see what you think. Mr. Deity is riled up. We're going to talk to Brian Dalton here in just a few. Next up on the agenda tonight, I've got Michael DeDora. He's the director of the CFI, the Center for Inquiry's Office of Public Policy, and the organization's representative to the United Nations. He's appeared on a bunch of media outlets throughout the U.S. and internationally. He's been featured on the New York Times, NBC, ABC, the BBC Radio, The Ron Reagan Show, Village Voice, and a whole lot more. He runs a blog. It's called The Moral Perspective, and he's currently overseeing two CFI projects. One is called The Campaign for Free Expression, and the other is called Keep Healthcare Safe and Secular. Michael, thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thanks for having me, Seth. I'm glad to be here.
What exactly is your role with the CFI? What do you do?
My role at the Center for Inquiry is director of the Office of Public Policy. So the Office of Public Policy is one of the center's various different programs, including the Council for Secular Humanism and the Committee for Skeptical Inquiry. And the Office of Public Policy is tasked with taking CFI's mission to advance science, reason, secular values, and humanist ethics, and apply those directly to areas of public policy.
Under the larger umbrella of human rights, we're addressing the tragedy in France, the very controversial issue of Charlie Hebdo. You bring a perspective that is unlike many of my other guests. You aren't an ex-Muslim. You didn't extricate yourself from a Muslim country or like an Islamist sort of culture or regime. You bring kind of a Western perspective to it, but you obviously have opinions, especially when it comes to free expression and human rights. Talk to me about Charlie Hebdo. And things like the Pope's reaction to Charlie Hebdo. Kind of give me your gut on the whole thing.
It is true that, you know, I'm not an ex-Muslim. I don't know exactly at a personal level what it's like to live in some places that are experiencing these troubles. You know, that being said, I've communicated pretty consistently with a lot of people who do live in these places. And I know pretty well what they're going through. And that's really enlightening to me and informs a lot of the activism that I do and that we do here at the center. In regards to the Charlie Hebdo cartoons, you know, CFI has kind of a historical place here because back in 2005, I believe it was, when the Danish cartoons were causing a lot of controversy, our magazine, Free Inquiry, was the first and one of the only magazines to republish those cartoons here in the U.S. And you know, the reason why CFI published those cartoons and the reason why we also decided to publish some of the cartoons of Charlie Hebdo on the front page of our website after the attack, you know, was not even necessarily because we thought they were great cartoons or that we necessarily agreed with any of the messaging in the cartoons, but the idea of free expression necessarily depends on the concept that it protects nearly all expression, whether or not you approve of it or not. If free expression was a principle that was kind of based on people's feelings and emotions, and they had the veto power to say that this thing kind of makes me a little bit queasy and I don't think it should be published in newspapers, then free expression really doesn't mean anything. So CFI takes a very strong position on freedom of expression, you know, and that's a position that we believe is fully supported by international human rights law, that people should be able to mock religion, people should be able to ridicule religion just as they mock and ridicule political ideas. Of course, many countries do not allow their citizens to do this kind of thing, but the world that we're working toward is a world where everyone has the right to express themselves freely on issues of religion, politics, culture, society. The Pope, what he said was basically that obviously everyone has the right to freedom of expression, but you know, not everyone has the right to kind of mock or make faith or religion out to be some kind of silly thing. And I think that goes to show that he perhaps doesn't have a full grasp on what the concept of free expression is. Maybe he hasn't read the international human rights treaties on these things. Maybe he hasn't kept up with a lot of the literature on this, or maybe he just has kind of a narrow opinion on freedom of expression, as many religious leaders do. I mean, it's probably not surprising to learn that, for example, many of the Fox News anchors have over the years been very critical of anyone who's ever spoken critically of Christianity. But of course, you know, they're in an uproar anytime there's any kind of thing involving Islamic believers criticizing cartoons and things like that. So, you know, there's a bit of a double standard there. And that's something that, you know, we wish to call out, obviously. What's really most bothersome, I think, about what the Pope said is that he is allowing, again, and this goes back to what I was talking about, he's allowing individuals to decide what is within the bounds of free expression based on kind of their own personal subjective feelings. And that is just something that is not in accordance with the way that, you know, the concept of free expression has been understood, especially in international human rights law the past 20 or 30 years. And it would make really a mess of trying to understand what free expression is. If it is, again, up to people to kind of veto the expressions that they hear because they don't like them, and it's a completely subjective thing, we might have, you know, a society in which no one can really say anything.
Reveals a tremendous amount of insecurity, I would think, if you're so threatened by an idea, good, bad, or indifferent, you know, any kind of idea. Was it Christopher Hitchens who said that the most acerbic, acidic, even the ugliest of speech among us is the most critical to be protected? Those are the ideas that absolutely must be heard, because if we only protect the speech that we agree with or like, then it's not free speech at all.
That's exactly right. And listen, there are, you know, as I've been in discussions about this, this has come up, there are areas of speech that we do look at more critically than others in terms of potentially curtailing it. You know, this is the kind of speech, though, that is not Islam is not true, or Christianity is not true, or Muhammad or Noah were bad human beings criticizing specific parts of the Bible or the Quran. The kind of speech that we look at more closely with an eye on trying to curtail it is, you know, kind of speech that's incitement to hatred or immediate violence. You know, the kind of speech that says all Muslims are terrorists and we should all treat them as kind of lesser human beings, or all people of a certain racial category are endowed with certain characteristics by virtue of their being black or white, etc. And that is very different, though, of course, than what I said before, you know, criticizing ideas, you know, historical ideas or religious ideas. And so,
yeah, you can't go out and say, I'm going to kill the president. It's not like all speech is protected, even speech that promotes hate and incites violence. I totally understand that.
Right. But that is different. And I think when we talk about free speech as an absolute idea, I really do think that it's an absolute idea, because I don't consider if someone goes out or makes a blog post or something, you know, calling for, again, trying to rile people up to, you know, attack others or stereotype others, I don't really necessarily consider that, you know, a form of speech. This is not like someone is kind of engaging in their own personal criticism of others' ideas. This is, again, a very different thing than what the cartoonist at Charlie Hebdo or anyone else who's really been in trouble for criticizing other religious ideas. And, you know, by the way, that includes a lot of religious believers, because for us kind of in the West, it's very easy to see this as kind of a war between non-religion or religion, or one religion and the other. But you know, the people who unfortunately face the worst punishment and the worst discrimination based on blasphemy laws, laws like blasphemy laws, are actually Muslims. You know, they're actually Muslims and Christians who live in places like Pakistan, Afghanistan, and those laws are used against them very often in cases which don't even involve blasphemy. But that just goes to show you how a very, very harmful concept could actually be even more harmful when put into a society that that will use it in various different ways to punish its people.
All my best with your work at the CFI. Thanks for lending your perspective to the conversation tonight. And your work is greatly appreciated, my friend.
As is yours. Thank you very much for having me, Seth. I appreciate it.
As we were speaking on the chat room, gentleman named Fred said something I thought was, he actually articulated much better than I did, so I'll just share what he said. He said, in regard to hate speech, race is not chosen, gender identity is not chosen, initial nationality is not chosen. Children do not choose their religion, it is forced upon them. To attack people on such a basis would be hate speech, but criticizing ideas, if someone accepts a religion, they are embracing irrational or wrong-headed ideas. Lampooning those ideas do not fall under the umbrella of hate speech. This, of course, would be disagreed with by Bill Donahue, who wrote an article just a couple of weeks ago for the Catholic League, an article that drew the ire of a great many people, and his short article said this. He said, killing in response to insult, no matter how gross, must be unequivocally condemned. That's why what happened in Paris cannot be tolerated. But neither should we tolerate the kind of intolerance that provoked this violent reaction. Those who work at this newspaper have a long and disgusting record of going way beyond the mere lampooning of public figures, and this is especially true of their depictions of religious figures. For example, they've shown nuns masturbating and popes wearing condoms. They've also shown Muhammad in pornographic poses. While some Muslims today object to any depiction of the Prophet, others do not. Moreover, visual representations of him are not prescribed by the Quran. What unites Muslims in their anger against Charlie Hebdo is the vulgar manner in which Muhammad has been portrayed. What they object to is being intentionally insulted over the course of many years. On this aspect, I am in total agreement with them. Stéphane Charbonnier, the paper's publisher, was killed today in the slaughter. It's too bad that he didn't understand the role he played in his tragic death. In 2012, when asked why he insults Muslims, he said, "Muhammad isn't sacred to me." Had he not been so narcissistic, he may still be alive. Muhammad isn't sacred to me either, but it would never occur to me to deliberately insult Muslims by trashing him. Anti-Catholic artists in this country have provoked me to hold many demonstrations, but never have I counseled violence. This, however, does not empty the issue. Madison was right when he said, "Liberty may be endangered by the abuses of liberty, as well as the abuses of power." Again, that's Bill Donahue and the Catholic League. And the article's called "Muslims Are Right to Be Angry." I'll tell you who else is angry tonight, and that's Brian Dalton. He's a friend. He's producer of satirical short films that have become hugely popular on the internet, most probably known as Mr. Deity. He's also known from the Way of the Mister clips, and he's joining us on the switchboard tonight. Hey, Brian, how's it going?
Good, good. How are you?
I'm well. You know, you've got such a good nature about you. You know, you're always smiling, or you're always in such a pleasant way. And most of your humor seems to be kind of that as well. You know, you're more of a, I don't know, you're more of a surgeon. You know, you kind of like to sneak in there and you do a lot of subversive stuff. And no matter what's going on screen, there always seems to be something you're sort of doing under the surface. Is that intentional, Brian? You're always kind of trying to throw a little byline into, you know, the script so that you're sending a message almost subliminally, or what?
Yeah, there's always, you know, little things that I throw in there. A lot of them are just for my own personal amusement, but sometimes I'm trying to slip something in. the irony is a lot of the times I have people write me and say, oh, you did this thing and that was absolutely brilliant, and I had no intention of doing it for that reason or whatever. So people read stuff in as well. But yeah, I try to throw as much as I can get into an episode. I'll throw it in there.
So you post this recent video, and I put it immediately on the Thinking Atheist social media pages because I thought it was compelling. And it's called Fuck the Pope. And you unloaded on the Supreme Pontiff. And I thought at that moment, I got to talk to Brian and see what's going on here. I mean, this wasn't played for laughs, or if it was, it had certainly had a razor's edge to it. What drove that? I mean, was the response to the Pope, did it just trigger something in you or what?
I woke up that morning. The way it's stated in the video itself is absolutely true. I woke up that morning and looked through my Flipboard, which is my obsession, and saw that story. And I had to actually source it three places before I felt confident that it was real. I was so outraged, and I found it so outrageous that I thought maybe I'm being punked. Maybe it's an Onion story that someone picked up and ran with. I could not believe that in the 21st century, you have the head of the Catholic Church saying you cannot make fun of the faith of others. It's so outrageous. And in the light of the attacks in Paris, to say such a thing, I was steaming mad, and I get angry, and then I pace around. And finally I just sat down and said, I have to write something. I have to shoot this today. It was my day off, thank heavens. And I literally shot that within 2 hours of writing it. And it was probably early in the day. And then I did have to go in for some later work I had to do that day. But so I didn't get it up till 3 a.m. the next morning, but I was just livid. I was absolutely livid. It seemed to me such a defense of what happened there. If you say something against religion, you can expect physical violence. It was outrageous.
He's essentially saying, well, it may have kind of been your fault. You know, yeah. you cartoonist, I mean, you should have known better. You shouldn't insult people's faith. It really did seem like he was acquiescing in front of the entire planet.
Yes, but to actually say the words, you cannot make fun of the faith of others, which I think is the exact quote. I may be getting a word off here and there. What century is he living in? Is he back in the 16th century, or what's going on there? Because we've been making fun of the faith of others. You know, I love Bill Maher's line where he said apparently he doesn't watch HBO. I mean, yeah. Clearly he doesn't watch my show because I've been making fun of the faith of others for 8 years. And, the one area where he might be right is you cannot make fun of the faith of Islam. Yeah. I mean, and not risk, you know, some serious harm.
Well, but, I mean, I know it's your intellectual property and whatnot, but if you'll abide me, I'm going to play like just a few seconds of your little tirade for our listening audience so they can get kind of a flavor. And then I'll link to it in the description box because I want everybody to go and be able to watch the entire thing. That cool?
Sure. Yeah.
All right. Here we go.
As though the Catholic Church hadn't already done everything it possibly could to absolutely obliterate the moral credibility it never had, this morning I woke up to the Pope, the Vicar of Christ, the head of the Holy Roman Catholic Church, advocating actual physical violence in response to offensive or provocative speech, thereby inciting violence and coddling the terrorist who killed my fellow satirist last week at the French weekly Charlie Hebdo. If my good friend, Dr. Gaspari, says a curse word against my mother, he can expect a punch. It's normal. You cannot provoke. You cannot insult the faith of others. You cannot make fun of the faith of others. There are so many people who speak badly about religions or other religions, who make fun of them, who make a game out of the religions of others. They are provocateurs, and what happens to them is what would happen to Dr. Gaspari if he says a curse against my mother. There is a limit. Well, I have three words for you, Pope Frankie. Fuck you, asshole. I not only can make fun of the faith of others, I do it professionally, you sick,
totalitarian bastard, you terrorist apologist. Your claim to be connected to some higher power gets you no pass from criticism, ridicule, and mockery, you self-important jerkwad. And by the way, does the fact that I'm so deeply offended by what you've said now give me the right to physically harm Catholics, destroy Catholic property, or say something like, well, you know, if the Pope gets assassinated, well, the Pope brought it on himself. You simple-minded, mouth-breathing provocateur. Let me explain to you, Pope Violence, why you're dead wrong. Because apparently the 2,000 years of your own vile, wicked, totalitarian history has taught you absolutely nothing about basic human decency, you sick fuck.
Is this the sort of the satirist in you? I mean, you know, you're an artist, you're a producer, you're a filmmaker, you're a writer, you're one of those people who uses the medium to challenge the quote-unquote sacred cows out there. This hits pretty close to home for you, I guess.
It really does. I mean, I consider myself first and foremost a satirist, and to see people killed over, I mean, it's outrageous to see people murdered over something they said. I mean, Islam is literally the religion now that they can't take a joke. I mean, this is it's absolutely baffling to me that someone would think of harming another person physically over something they simply say. There's, you know, as Jefferson said, so long as it doesn't pick my pocket or break my legs, what do I care? And apparently, you know, this is the kind of thing that religion does. It makes people so hypersensitive over their sacred cows or prophets that you get this kind of thing going on. You don't. I mean, can you imagine this at a scientist going in and killing satirists?
Yeah.
For saying E equals MC squared is bullshit. You know, I mean, it's.
Yeah, I understand your frustration. You know, I'm reminded, you know, you and I are about the same age. We're both young men, Brian.
Yes.
Remember back in the late 80s when artist and photographer posted the crucifix?
Yes, Piss Christ.
Yeah, Piss Christ. It's a crucifix submerged in a glass of urine, and it won some awards, and it became
Andre
this
Toronto, year. I believe was his name.
Lightning rod of controversy. And yes. Nobody anywhere walked into his house or into an art show with an AK-47 or whatever and wasted the guy. I mean, you know, there were people acting wounded, but at no point, I'm sure, did he fear that he would be executed for this. And what we're looking at now is a whole other animal, man.
Yeah. And, you know, people who are upset at people calling out Islam, saying that's racist or bigoted or whatever you want, you know, that doesn't happen. That doesn't happen in the Christian and Jewish world. And I'm not saying that Christianity or Judaism is any better, because if they had the kind of political power and were able to have their bullshit disseminated without anyone calling them out, like Islam does pretty much throughout the Middle East, this kind of thing would be going on at the hands of Christians too. I don't want anyone to think that, you know, I'm singling them out because they're worse per se. They are simply worse right now. If we went back four centuries, I would be crapping all over the Christians because they did the same thing. I mean, they killed people. They murdered people for heresy, which is the same exact thing. So it's not that one religion is any worse than the others. They're all awful. But right now, at this point in time, there is one religion who hasn't joined us in the 21st century, whereas the other ones have had to pretty much moderate because they've taken it in the seat by the secular societies that they live in, who won't tolerate this kind of thing.
What's the satirist do now? I mean, you double down, you know, you crank up the volume even more. Do you push the edge of the envelope even more? What's the move, man?
I think you have to. I really think you have to, because you have to stand up to this and say, you know, what is the option? You back down and say, oh, okay, I'm not going to say anything against Islam or the prophet. Well, I'm sorry, if the prophet said something that's bullshit, we're going to say it's bullshit. And I think you have to stand up and say that regardless. I understand that some people may not want to do that. They have families also that they don't want to put at risk. And I get that within news organizations who don't want to show the cartoons and that kind of thing. There's part of me that says, oh, just stop it and go for it. But I do understand the other side of it as well. But, you know, from my personal point of view, I do think I'm just about to shoot something about atheist fundamentalism that I've written that will go up in a few weeks after the Richard Dawkins episode that really kind of crystallizes my feeling about all of these religions and the danger that they pose. And it, for me, it all comes back to these books, these evil, wicked books that have God, you know, ordering genocide or the murder of young girls who don't show evidence of virtue on their wedding night, or homosexuals should be murdered. These kinds of books, there's no other group on the planet right now has a book that they pledge loyalty to wherein genocide is looked at fondly. You know, that yeah. only happens in religions. And, I don't know world. I know Christianity, Judaism, Mormonism. I know Islam a little, not as well. But, you know, are there other religions who have that? I don't know. But this horrible book from which everything is based has to be the end of our respect for people who honor that book and the being the main character in that book.
Yeah, ideas aren't guaranteed respect. You know,
they are not.
There's no idea that's off limits out there. You know, back to the Pope real quick, and I know you're a busy guy and you have places to be, but I heard a lot, and I find myself even to a degree saying it myself in a few instances when the Pope would say or do something that sounded rather progressive or almost progressive. I thought, wow, that's refreshing. And hey, that's kind of nice to hear, whether he's, you know, being inclusive of atheists or, you know, he's at the Synod Assembly talking about divorcees being able to serve before he was shot down and right. maybe opening the tent. This is back in the fall, opening the tent to include non-heterosexuals. We're all like, hey, how refreshing. And right. he has totally blown any equity he ever had in the last 4 weeks. It's just a spiral downward.
Well, you know, Michael Shermer and I did a video where I played the Pope and we talked about, because, you know, he's talked about all of these things and, you know, he sounds great. But the fact of the matter is, when push comes to shove and you're putting the pedal to the metal and we're seeing where the you know, everything meets up, nothing has changed.
Yeah, same song, different day, man.
It's a lot of great PR, but when you look at actually what's changed and what's going to change, well, you know, it's one of these hemming and hawing situations where nothing's going to happen. In fact, one of the things that we point out in that video is that he's actually doubled down on exorcism.
So, oh, yes, yeah, I saw that article just the other day.
What? You sounded so progressive. Now you're taking us back to the 1300s? What the hell are you thinking?
You know, with the Fuck the Pope video, you are not going to be invited to Mass. I'm just saying you're off the list forever, Brian.
So yeah, I'm okay with that, because this is truly one of the great evil empires throughout all of history. I do think Catholicism really is the foundation of all totalitarian regimes ever since, because they had totalitarianism down. If you read your history through the Middle Ages and even up right up into the early Renaissance, this was a totalitarian organization that set pretty much the pattern for every totalitarian regime hence. And the wickedness that has come out of this one single religion, not that, you know, Protestants haven't done well on their own. They've done a great job. But boy, this one organization is just, I would love to see this one just go the way of the dodo.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, to watch a person attempt to empathize with poor people from the pinnacle position of a multi-billion-dollar corporation, it just doesn't exactly ring true. Plus the anti-science nature. I mean, the same church that condemned and imprisoned Galileo for the heinous thought that we didn't, that the sun didn't revolve around us. Just one after the other, the greatest hits of really shitty moves.
Yeah.
And, yeah. And so now, you know, now we're faced with, you know, kind of a clueless Pope, but certainly a dangerous radical Islam out there. And I appreciate the work that you do in helping to spread some rationality, my friend.
Well, thank you very much. I write back at you.
All right, we will be looking for the next week. You got Dawkins on. When's that going to happen? And how was he to work with? I mean, was he cool? Was he kind of aloof?
He was awesome. He did such a great job. He had a very short time, so yeah. We shot it in a very unconventional manner, where I shot his side and green screened him into my shots and me into his, because he had, you know, the man has no time. He's one of the busiest people I've ever known. And we've been trying to get together to do this for years and years and years. And finally, he was in the area. He told me, I have an hour. So we got him in here. He was amazing. He did a fantastic performance. The script was great. It's kind of co-written by the two of us, although I'm probably going to take all the credit. And
as you should. Well, you know, when we did the interview in D.C. a while back in advance of his memoir, he was hugely generous, a tremendous, tremendous guy. But he was a little bit shy, and he just, I don't know, always got the vibe he was kind of in his own head. He's just on a whole other level, you know.
He is the sweetest man I have ever met. He has this beautiful, genteel, kind way about him. He's, you know, people think of him as this acerbic, you know, just
strident. Yeah, it's the word they always use.
Warrior. And he's just the sweetest man ever. And I love him. And I love just talking with him and hanging out with him. My favorite moment in the last 10 years of my life is when I met him for the first time. I stuck my hand out. I said, Richard, you're my hero. And he said, no, you're mine. And I went, oh my gosh. Can you say that again?
Good night. Good night, everybody. That's all you need.
I did the mic drop right there.
But I don't mean to make this about Dawkins. Did you see the new video they just posted of him reading his new hate mail?
Yes.
Oh, it's awesome.
The first one, though, kills me even more. It's so beautifully done with the setting and the, you know.
Oh, yeah, when he's sitting in his house or whatever.
Much, yeah, this was a little more joking on the joke of it all. But the first one is brilliant satire.
Somebody said something in this new one about go and have sexual relations with a satanic monkey from hell. I mean, I don't know what kind of stuff was happening. So,
hey, Brian, are creative in their hatred. You got to hand it to them.
I appreciate you, my friend, and thanks for sharing your perspective. And you keep swinging for the fences out there. You do great work, and we'll be in touch soon. Okay.
All right. Thank you very much.
You know, what's funny is we were talking about the Pope. The chat room here is many people have said that they think this sort of Pope light as of the last, you know, 18 months has been the church's desperate attempt to try to stop the bleeding. People leaving the church, leaving the church, leaving the church. And so the Pope has been trying to be more inclusive. You know, he's nicer. He's more accessible. Many people don't think it's genuine at all. They think this is a PR move. The church is a business, and it's trying to keep customers. I thought that was an interesting sort of an angle on it. My next two guests are going to bring sort of an insider's perspective to the issue of Islam itself. And of course, we'll speak about Charlie Hebdo. Ali Rizvi is a Pakistani-Canadian writer. He is a physician and musician. He lives in Toronto. He's working on a book that's called The Atheist Muslim. He wrote an article which was published on the 9th of this month, featured in the Huffington Post. The article was called How Terrorism One. And Faisal Saeed Al-Muttar is an Iraqi-born writer. He's a public speaker, a community manager. He's a computer geek and a human rights activist. He lives in the U.S. He is the founder of the Global Secular Humanist Movement and the Secular Post. Both of these gentlemen joined me tonight. Thanks for being a part of the show, guys.
Hey, thanks for having us, Seth.
Thank you.
Ali, I'm going to start with you. What's an atheist Muslim? What is that?
Well, the title of the book is sort of tongue-in-cheek. It started with a conversation I was having with a friend who claims to be a feminist Muslim. And I asked her, I was like, isn't this sort of like being a meat-eating vegetarian or, you know, a Jewish Nazi? And it was all in jest. You know, we just talked about cherry-picking, and she said she thought it was completely consistent. So it's like, okay, we can cherry-pick. Why can't I cherry-pick all the way to non-belief? And you know, I'll keep some of the things I liked from my childhood, like the feasts of Ramadan and some of the other things that I like, the charity aspect and all that stuff. And I'll just give up all the supernatural stuff and be an atheist Muslim if you can be an LGBT Muslim or a feminist Muslim. So it's basically a stab at that. And the second part of it's a little bit more serious, that I did grow up in Muslim countries. A lot of my family and friends are Muslim. So there is a lot that I shared sort of culturally with them growing up. And that there is such a thing as, you know, certain, that there are Muslim aspects of culture as well. So the idea is that you shouldn't have to, just because you're abandoning your faith doesn't mean that you have to abandon your community. Unfortunately, for too many Muslims around the world, that's the case. Once they decide to change their mind about faith, they get disowned by their family, or they can't go back to the country that they grew up in, or, you know, they're in jail, and, you know, they're getting flogged, right? Like our friend, Raif Badawi. So that's also part of it. So it just means a whole bunch of things. I mean, it's not the way I describe myself. I don't call myself an atheist Muslim, but that is the title of the book.
How long did you live in Pakistan?
I lived in Pakistan for about 11 or 12 years on and off. I was born there. And then Saudi Arabia for another 11 or 12 years. So, and then Libya for about 6 years, 5-6 years.
Well, as I'm watching the story of, you mentioned Raif Badawi, the Saudi blogger who has been sentenced to 1,000 lashes.
Yeah.
In fact, they just suspended the rest of the lashings. What they did, one, and they jacked him up so bad that they are suspending it so that he can heal, so that they can get on with the rest of the lashes. Is that how I'm to understand the story?
Well, Bill Maher said, he said, see, we are compassionate. There are moderate Muslims. And that was his, that was his take on it. I mean, yeah, Wow. That's the thing. It is, it's a sick kind of thing to do. Then, okay, fine. You know, we'll be nice to you and let your wounds heal so we can rip them open again.
I'm going to come back to that.
You know?
I'm going to come back to that. Faisal, talk to me. I know that you're from Iran and you have very strong opinions about Islam as a religion.
Well, I'm from Iraq. We're not the same thing.
Oh, that's the second time I've done that. And it's funny because my notes still say Iraq, and I always say it wrong. I did some sort of a weird mental tic. So let me ask it again.
I will accuse you of racism for this.
Iraq be a race?
You mentioned that I have strong opinions. I mean, it is kind of extremely ironic. Like when I came here to America, that many people, including people who are very highly educated, who think that Islam is a race. I mean, I don't really have strong opinions as much as I'm stating facts. I mean, I'm not really trying to generalize on all Muslims or talking about how Islam is the most dangerous thing in the world. I mean, I was stating facts generally. You listen to my speech at the Apostacon, and what I mostly was stating was statistics from pure research, a lot of research done from local universities and interviews being done with people like Al-Qaeda and others that I take from journalists working in Iraq and around the Middle East. And so I'm not really trying to portray all Muslims as some sort of different people or second class citizens. I mean, and me personally, I grew up in a progressive liberal Muslim family. I mean, my relationship, I still have a relationship with my parents, I still have a relationship with my family, and I acknowledge that there is a significant number of Muslims who are peaceful, liberal, and progressive, but at the same time, there's also a significant percentage of Muslims who are not. And we have to be honest about the beliefs of these people and the action that is committed as a result of the beliefs. Also, when it comes to Islam, and we are talking about 1.6 billion people. So even if we're going to say, like, even if we're going to be so conservative, okay? Like, we're going to be so conservative. We're going to be so pro-Islam, okay? And we say that only 10% of Muslims hold extreme ideas. And I'm being conservative by cutting it to 10%. I mean, if you look at pure research, if you look at statistics being done, like in Pakistan and Egypt, there are more than 60-70% of the Egyptian and Pakistani population believe that apostates should be killed. And that is the report published in the Washington Post and Reuters. So I'm being very conservative by pulling the percentage to 10%. So if we're going to say 10% of Muslims are extremists, okay, that is 150 million people. Okay, because Islam is the second largest religion. So if we're going to say, even if the statement is the majority of Muslims are, let's say, moderate, it's still 10%, when we're going to talk about 10% of the Muslim world, it's still a very significant amount of people. That has been my main point, is that even if that the extremists do not make up the majority of the Muslim world, but they do make up a large number in terms of quantity.
Charlie Hebdo, is that true Islam? I'll start with you, Ali. Come on. Does that reflect what Islam is?
Does that reflect what Islam is? Charlie Hebdo,
or you can rephrase the question if you feel the question unfair. But when those say, well, that's not true Islam, that's not what the Islamic faith really is.
I would say that it's compatible with it. I mean, there is enough in the if you go by the Quran, right? I mean, here's the thing. Like, you know, the question is, how do you judge Islam or how do you judge any religion? And you shouldn't judge it by the actions of a few. And by the actions of a few, we're not talking about, you know, that all means Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and that also means all of the liberal progressive Muslims out there. You can't judge it by their actions. What you can judge it by is by the content of its canonical text, just like any other religion. That's the one thing that's consistent across all Islamic sects. So if we look at the content, then yes, I mean, there's several places where, I mean, verse 8:12 and 8:13, they say that, you know, that God said to the angels that I will cast terror into the hearts of disbelievers. So smite them upon the necks and cut off all their fingertips. And then in the next verse, right afterwards, it says, and whosoever opposes Allah and his messenger will suffer the same penalty. So this is, it's clearly endorsed in the Quran. It's also endorsed in multiple other verses. I just gave you one example. So, I mean, to say that this has nothing to do with Islam, or it's, that Islam is a religion of peace and this doesn't represent it, is very disingenuous. And I think more and more, especially recently, people are beginning to see through that. They're beginning to see that sort of the dishonest, disingenuous narrative that comes out after all of these events.
I'm glad you brought that up. You know, Faisal, I want you to address this because you've done it in the past and you always do it so well. People say Islam means peace. You want to help define what Islam means or how they mean to achieve peace?
Yes. I mean, I think that a question about what is true Islam is very close to say what is true astrology. I mean, we really have to identify that we do have a religion, and religion was created by other people. And this book is up to interpretations by many different people. So to say that there is a true Islam is to say that there is true astrology, in my opinion. But what we can judge is that what is called the interpretations at the schools within the Islamic doctrine, and to see the percentage of the people who follow these schools, and we see the action that is committed as a result of belief in these schools. So when it comes to the topic of Charlie Hebdo, or even the topic of killing Yazidis in Iraq, and this is, I'm quoting actually an Islamic scholar who is an Iraqi Islamic scholar, his name is Ayat Jamaluddin, who said that the idea that Muslim, like he was talking about the Yazidis killed in Iraq, and he said that that is something agreed upon by both the Sunni and the Shia schools of interpretation, that the people who worship supposedly Satan, according to some people, think that the Yazidis worship Satan, should be killed. And the same thing about the issue about caricaturing of the prophet. This is something that is agreed upon by a very large amount of Sunni and Shia scholars, that those who portray the prophet have to be punished. And the difference is, I mean, if you look at like what the scholars say, is that the difference is that they all agree there has to be a punishment. Some of them tends to be, they should be in jail, and some of them tends to be, let's kill them all. For the term Islam, I mean, it means submission, and it means submission to the will of God. And actually, Al-Rizvi posted yesterday, said that those who claim that Islam is a religion of peace have to provide this with evidence, because extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. When you claim that any ideology, whether it's Islam, whether it's any ideology, Islam, Christianity, communism, capitalism, name it, if you're going to claim that it is this way, I mean, including those who claim that Islam is a religion of violence, they also have to cite where do they make up this conclusion from. I think that Islam is a contradictory religion. So it's really hard to figure out. And that discussion is being held right now between many Muslims about actually what the hell is Islam. As you can see, I mean, most of the people who are killed by ISIS and Al-Qaeda are actually Muslims because they differ about interpretation about what Islam means.
I read the article yesterday, the day before, about ISIS taking the two gay or professed gay or people suspected of being gay. These guys took them to the top of a tall tower and threw them to their deaths and stoned a woman accused of adultery. And they crucified 15, 17 guys. It's just a wave of barbarism and terror. And for those of us who don't have an inside out view of Islam and the Muslim cultures and the different sort of shades of Islam, it's so incredibly challenging. I'm sure it is for you guys as well. But I mean, can you imagine the rest of us? We're looking at this and thinking, I don't see Baptists sawing the heads off of people in the name of God these days. I think Islam is a different animal, or there's a phenomenon happening where the most batshit people among us are grabbing Islam as an excuse to be crazy. We don't know what to do with all this. So, I mean, Ali, where do we begin in understanding and solving the problem, in your opinion?
Well, I mean, there's precedent for it. I mean, it's when you mentioned this, the stoning to death of adulterers, killing gay people, and when we're talking about religion, the idea, and then the people who follow it, there's a really interesting precedent we can go on. It's the Old Testament. Okay, Leviticus 20:13 says that gay people should be killed. Leviticus 24:16 says that blasphemers who malign the name of the Lord should be killed. So these things are all in the Old Testament. The Old Testament, the stoning of, in Deuteronomy 22:20-21, it says that the woman who is not found to be a virgin on her wedding night should be taken to her father's doorstep and stoned to death by the entire town. So these are all things that are in the Old Testament. Now the question is, why are the people who revere the Old Testament, or, the Jews and the Christians, why aren't they doing this en masse? Whereas the Quran, which is also brutal, like all the other holy books, why are the followers of it doing these things? And the only difference really between the two religions is that one of them, right, with Muslims, more Muslims adhere to the Quran and take that as the literal word of God than do Christians and Jews about Old Testament and the Bible in general. So when you get to the point of, defining Islam versus defining Muslims or defining Judaism versus defining Jews, then that's also another reason why it's so important to differentiate between ideas and people, right? So the way that we do it, the way we actually move forward with Islam and move it towards progressivism, to make it more progressive, is to dissociate this idea of ideology. But just instead of them coming together on a sense of ideology, they should come together on a sense of community. And I think that's what's more important. I mean, when Catholics, the Pope says that, don't use condoms and don't have abortions. But the majority of Catholics, use birth control. The majority of them cohabitate with, out of wedlock. The majority of them are pro-choice. But nobody ever goes up to them and says, you're not a Catholic. You're not a true Catholic. Nobody ostracizes them. I mean, they've moved beyond that. The same thing with the Jewish people. I mean, they're Jewish atheists, Jewish agnostics, and they can openly say it. And nobody really asks them why they're not adhering to the Torah. So when Muslims get to that point, right, and the precedent has shown us that people can get to that point, they can actually move past the idea of scriptural inerrancy, the idea that scripture is perfect, and they can move past that and really, come together on a sense of community and retain what they like and, move on. So I think that Muslims can do it. It's just that it's probably going to take a lot more time.
I think that political identity, which is something very important, is that many Muslims tend to identify, and there are many research being done, especially on the immigrants, for example, living in the UK and Germany and so on, that when they ask them first, do you identify first as a Muslim or a British? And there is a large percentage to say we identify first as a Muslim before we are British. But on the other hand, for example, we see people like Majid Nawaz, who's the head of the Kalam Foundation, and his whole main theory, if I'm going to explain it right, is that people if they get to switch identities, that means the first identity, let's say I am a liberal Muslim, and then so they interpret Islam according to liberal values. So what happens is it's a game changer, because when the first person identity is a Muslim, that changes everything, because he can interpret things on face value regardless of other views that are out there. I mean, it's kind of need an article to explain this whole idea. But when people say that they are Muslim first, and we can see this with ISIS, when people from all over, from Canada, from the United States, from Australia, who fly all the way from these countries to Iraq and Syria to fight with ISIS, but what really brings these people together is a sense of one political identity or one identity. We're all brothers, and there's this sense of universalism within Islam that has to be kind of discussed.
Basil, it's funny how you sort of couch that when you talk about how some of these people are recruited or why it's attractive to them. It almost sounds like gang cultures looking for disenfranchised young men, you know, to come be a part of the gang, and they get in that a sense of belonging and purpose and security and brotherhood. It's a cultural choice.
Yeah, it is to some extent. I mean, there are people who, like, if you look at the research that is done on a lot of people who got recruited, who became in ISIS, you will see that many of them joined in, obviously, for ideological purposes, as well as finding some sort of identity. The way that they recruit people is that Muslims who are being discriminated against by the West, by Israel, you name it, and you come and join us to fight against them. So this person does not think that I am a British first. He will think that, oh, look, there are Muslim brothers who are getting discriminated against in Iraq, and I'm going to go to Iraq and fight against my fellow British citizens, because he doesn't think of himself as a British. That is one of the main issues that's facing now in Western Europe. And if back to Charlie Hebdo, one of the terrorists that committed the attack are from France. They're not from Mars. They were born and raised, some of them were born and raised in France, who got recruited. So yeah, this thing may continuously happen. I mean, we really need to have this conversation as much as possible to be able to identify the key elements of terrorism and how to deal with them. And we have to create the platform, and I'm working in a platform called movements.org, which is our Middle Eastern section, is to modernize, is to support these reformer Muslims and those who are fighting against bad ideas and fight against dictatorships and theocracies. And it needs to be happened, because I don't think we have a lot of time.
Ali, I'm stuck on something, and either one of you can respond. How can you be a Muslim and not hold to the Quran or believe the Quran? How can you just be a cultural Muslim but not hold to its holy book or pray five times a day? And what's the difference between a Muslim and an Islamist? Can you help us understand this?
Well, like, you know, it's the same thing with Catholics. And this is what I was kind of getting to before. You know, a lot of Catholics will not stick to the Bible. They'll cherry pick. They'll rationalize other things. Say, well, this actually meant this at that time, or I don't believe this, or I don't believe this part. These are the parts of the Bible I like, and this is what I'm going to take. Unfortunately, with Muslims, they haven't gotten to that point, but precedent has shown that they can. You know, they can cherry. I still think it's obviously it's dishonest, but it's still better, you know, than what you have going on. So I agree. Like, I think that, you know, if the Quran says that this is 100% the word of God, you either take all of it or you take none of it. That would be the logical step. So for me, I can't compartmentalize my mind that way. So I decided to take none of it, because I knew for sure that I couldn't take all of it. But for other people who are able to compartmentalize and they can somehow rationalize it to themselves, it's still a better position to be in, to interpret it in a peaceful way, however delusional that may be, and live your life that way rather than go all out and actually believe it all and become a jihadist.
Yeah, if we speak about those in Muslim cultures, or we speak about those who are so often oppressed by the most radical, the most violent, the most barbaric, quite often the people most oppressed, the people so often under the boot of radicals, are Muslims themselves, correct?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
As I explained before, is that there is a very different interpretations. I mean, like, the country that ISIS now controls 40% of is the country that I grew up in. you will see that, I mean, Sunnis, which is ISIS, is a Sunni militia. But Sunnis themselves differ on how much are you willing to use violence to advance your ideas or to advance your ideology. I mean, there are many people who agree that, for example, gays should be punished. But how many of them are willing to go take the gun and kill the gay? That is kind of what the debate is really about. So you look at these percentages that, like the research that's done, being done by Pew and others about, do you agree that apostates should be killed? Yes, the majority say yes. But how many of them are willing to do it like ISIS, in which they go to people's houses and start killing people? That is kind of where the influence of other ideologies, other than Sunni and Shia Islam, but rather Salafist and Wahhabi Islam, which are subsets of Sunni Islam, that make somebody go to take the violence, take the action, which is the military aspect of it. And also within Shia Islam, there is the principle of wilayat al-faqih, which is to use force to establish a theocracy. And it has been established well in Iran for the past 40 years. So you'll see that there are so many fights, because we generally think of like Islam versus West. But I mean, if you look at Iraq, you look at Pakistan, you see that there is a lot of wars that happen within Muslims. And they actually, that's what makes up most of the, if you're going to make a body count, you'll see that most of the deaths are actually are Muslims killing each other.
I saw a documentary, a frontline documentary. It was the aftermath of the last Iraqi war. And we had established, we'd put somebody in power, and then we sort of pulled everybody out. And as soon as we left, the sectarian violence continued, and ISIS continues to do what they do. And Iraq is hugely divided. And I noticed that on both sides, you know, you've got the ISIS and those rebelling against ISIS. Everybody is shouting in the name of God. God is great. God is with us. We will be martyrs if we must. Everybody's invoking God, and they're about completely different things.
Yes. Everyone invokes God to kill the other person who also invokes God. If you put it this way, I mean, if you look at the flag, if you look at the main powers who are fighting at the civil war in Iraq, it was Jaish al-Mahdi, who is inspired by Muqtada al-Sadr. Their flag is La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, which is the same thing said by ISIS.
And the flag of Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia says the exact same thing, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. And it's also underlined by a sword. There's a sword under it on the Saudi flag. So
yeah, there's some crush on the sword. There's always a crush on the sword. Everybody likes it. But you see that these people fight and kill each other all the time. And they use pretty much the same words in their motto, because there are many different interpretations. But even though what some people say, because like whenever there's discussion about Islam, and then you have like Reza Aslan, who's like, Islam is not monolithic. They always say this statement. But this statement is also false in a sense that there is a large chunk of Muslims, even though it's true that Islam is not monolithic, there is a large chunk, like there are a lot of things that Sunnis and Shias agree on. So it's not like really that diverse. I mean, Islam is not that really diverse.
I wanted to add one thing to that, what Faisal was saying, that we generally think, I think in the West, most people I talk to think of, that there's, you know, the moderate Muslims and they're not violent, and there's a small number of extremist Muslims that are violent, and that's pretty much all of Muslims. But it's not that simple. So you have jihadists who actually go out and commit the violence, and then you have many Islamists who are not jihadists. I mean, they agree with those principles. They support what the jihadists do, but they wouldn't necessarily do it themselves. You know, and some of these, like Anjum Chaudhry and so on, like, you know, some of these guys are very pro-jihad, they're Islamists, you know, they don't actually go out and do these things themselves. And then when you have moderate Muslims, and we talk about them like, you know, it's a huge chunk of people and they're all the same, the moderate Muslims tend to vary. The majority of moderate Muslims around the world are actually quite conservative. You know, they may not sympathize with the Islamists completely. They may not sympathize with the jihadists. They may only do it selectively. I mean, it's not that there isn't just one formula to it. But many of them are very conservative, and some of them are liberal as well. So there are many different subdivisions within these subdivisions too. I mean,
it's
it is
like
1.6
billion
people
with 1,000 heads. I mean, what? How do we approach? How do we solve? How do we handle this hugely?
I mean, in America, what I've figured is that when somebody does not behead people, he's a moderate. I don't think that is a good definition.
That is the definition, yeah.
Yeah, and that's the definition that's being used generally.
Yeah, that's it's a bit of a problem, because I do think that some of the, like, unfortunately, like, when you say the things I do, when you say the things that Fessel does, a lot of times, you know, you get a lot of support from people you really don't want support from. I mean, I always say that, like, you know, I have a Muslim sounding name, you know, I have brown skin, I grew up in Pakistan, Saudi Arabia and everything. So I am the kind of guy who would also get pulled over by the TSA for a random screening. You know, we've all been through that. So I do share that experience with Muslims. And I think that there is a big difference between genuine anti-Muslim bigotry and criticism of Islam. And unfortunately, like, when you do go out and you criticize Islam, like Fessel and I do, you do get a lot of support from genuine anti-Muslim bigots. And that's something I obviously don't appreciate. In fact, like, I think it's an injustice. Like, well, that's why words like Islamophobia, the reason that I despise that term so much is because it exploits the genuine experiences that victims of anti-Muslim bigotry go through. It exploits those experiences for the political agenda of, stifling criticism against Islam.
Somebody can oppose something for completely different reasons. I mean, I've met people who believe that there is a war between Christianity and Islam, and Muhammad was a false prophet, and Jesus is the real deal. And somehow there is a cosmic war between good and evil, and God supports Christians against Muslims. They're actually believe that, and when they hear some of our statements, and they added me on Facebook, and some of them also from the extreme right-wing Jews, and when I criticized the Torah, like, back a few days ago, there were some people who were pissed at me. They thought that I am somehow, like, pro-Torah. I'm like, I don't think you know me well enough to think that I'm supportive of any, I'm a fan of any religion. And you'll see that even within the so-called, like, ex-Muslim community or whatever, you'll see that a lot of people belong to many different groups, and they get support from many different groups. I mean, including people like Wafa Sultan and others who make statements that sometimes make it sound like to be anti-Islam, somehow you have to be pro-Israel or something like this. I mean, there is no correlation whatsoever.
A lot of people out there are anxious to co-opt any soapbox and sort of repaint it for their own purposes. I totally get that.
Yes, so I mean, if there is any advice I would give to your audience or to anyone, it's actually to check the agenda. When somebody is criticizing Islam, it's very important to know why they are criticizing it and what's really motivating them. Because there is genuine anti-Muslim bigotry, and there is genuine anti-immigrant bigotry that I'm sure Ali as well faced in Canada. I mean, in the United States, I mean, there is a lot of people that I have met or send me emails who, like, call me sad nigger, and they call me get the hell out of our country and you're stealing our jobs and things like this. I mean, I get these emails a lot. And these people actually have genuine hatred against people from the Middle East or people who are, like, Arabs or things like that. So it's very important.
I was going to add to the immigrant aspect is that I do hear this a lot, that, you know, there's, like, especially on in the right wing in Europe, a lot of European countries are criticizing immigration policy, and they're like, we have to do something about immigration policy. Thing is, if you make a blanket kind of decision like that, then people like myself and like Fessel wouldn't be here. We would be in the countries that we grew up in the same position that Raif Badawi is right now. And then the other thing I want to say about immigration is that most of these people that we're seeing in ISIS, they all have French accents, they have British accents, they have passports from Belgium, from the United States, from Canada, you know, from the UK. These are not things you can curb with immigration anymore. This is an ideology that has gone viral. It goes beyond borders. Using immigration, you know, just making this, if you have an anti-immigration agenda, using this as an excuse to curb that isn't really going to help people. It's actually going to harm people who should be helped. And
exactly, like the people who are escaping from there.
Yeah. These are complicated issues. There's a lot of aspects to it, and they have to be looked at from several different viewpoints. And
well, it's tragic. I'm from a part of the country where their solution to this is send them home, as if Islam has a home. It's like, you know, if Islam has a skin color.
This is their home. The Charlie Hebdo, the terrorists who did the attack on Charlie Hebdo, like, France is their home. You know, a lot of the guy that they caught in Ohio recently, the Christopher Cornell, And he's not the singer from Soundgarden, which I was glad to find, you know, out later. But he is, because his name is Chris Cornell, too. That's what I was getting at. But, you know, he's also homegrown. I mean, a lot of these people, Anwar al-Awlaki, who was in Yemen,
yeah,
taken out by a drone, he's an American citizen. So these are not people, this is their home, you know. So if you're asking them to go home, they're just going to go back to whatever suburb they're from.
You wrote a blog or an article for the Huffington Post, and it was called How Terrorism Won. You really think terrorism, yes, won? And in what context do you mean this?
Well, I was talking about the self-censorship of the U.S. media outlets. So at that point, like CNN, NBC, ABC, CBS, Fox, all of them decided not to show the cartoons. You know, then later on, even when they reprinted it and they had a cover, I mean, these were not obscene cartoons. There's nothing wrong with them. It was just a guy in a beard, the cartoon of a guy in a beard, and they wouldn't show it. So I kind of felt like, to me, that's what people do when they follow blasphemy laws. The blasphemy laws they have in the countries where I grew up and where Faisal grew up, this is precisely how you follow them, is that they tell you not to print certain things. They tell you not to say certain things. They tell you not to draw certain things. And you comply and you don't do it. That's exactly what most of the media outlets over here did. I found it actually very disappointing. Freedom of speech is a very, very particular thing for me, especially because I grew up in that part of the world and because I couldn't talk about a lot of things. I mean, when Rife will be set free, and eventually Rife will come to, hopefully, to Canada where the rest of his family is. If you ask him, you know, he will also tell you that freedom of speech is something he doesn't take for granted. For him, it was a very costly luxury. So when people like that and people like me and people like Faisal come over here to North America and we see this kind of behavior from major media outlets, it's very, very disappointing, because this is exactly how things work. This is, you know, you're saying that you want to curb terrorism, you want to prevent the terrorism attack. Well, you're not preventing terrorist attacks. You're the victim of a terrorist attack if you're complying with these people's threats.
The worst attitude I have seen from some Americans is, other than actually blaming the people who killed that cartoonist, I have heard people who were blaming the victims of the killing. They were saying like, yeah, oh, why did they draw the cartoon? Aren't a newspaper should be about love and peace? Why they are trying to offend people? There were actually people like here in America who were trying, and also they had some stupid people who are saying that the Charlie Hebdo cartoons were racist and these people deserve to be killed. I mean, there was some shameful attitude. And also, not to be reminded about the Salman Rushdie incident, about it happened like 20 years ago. Many people blamed Salman Rushdie for writing the book, other than blaming Ayatollah Khomeini, who issued the fatwa. They're like, why did you write the satanic verses? Why did you try to offend Muslims? You brought it to yourself. Like, other than saying, oh, no, we should defend the freedom of speech, we should defend the right for people to discuss ideas and criticize ideas, they blame the victims of the fatwas and the victims of terrorism. These people should be ashamed of themselves.
Speaking of blame, I've saved one of the hottest topics for the last part of the conversation, and I know you've spoken to this, Faisal, and either one of you guys or both can jump in here, but there is an attitude on the far, far, far left that this is our fault. The USA is essentially the entity that constructed the monster of radicalism in the Middle East, and we are ultimately to blame, and we should not be surprised that any of this is happening. And I'd like you to respond, if you would.
Let's take an example. I'm going to bring Rife, by the way, up again. You know, Rife, when he was flogged after that, everybody around him cheered, the crowd cheered, they all yelled, Allahu Akbar. They celebrated the flogging of this man who really didn't do anything except just write a few blog posts criticizing whatever he thought deserved criticism, including, you know, the regime, the clerics, and the in some cases, the religion as well. So he just simply did that. Now, that is something that Americans did not, you know, the West is not responsible for that. But what the West is responsible for is maintaining that, helping them maintain it. By supporting a lot of these regimes in the past, I mean, they have helped maintain it. But to say that they actually caused it, and to say that the reason that women are stoned to death for adultery, the reason that people are crucified, the reason that all those Yazidis were killed in Iraq, I mean, those Yazidis had nothing. They're not oil hungry. You know, they haven't colonized anybody. They haven't done anything. So to say that the West is responsible for that is completely false. you know, this is a virus. This is a huge problem. It's a cancer over there. And by supporting these regimes, the U.S. has, and the Western countries generally have helped them maintain it. And the reason that they're still able to get away with these sort of archaic, you know, legal codes like they do, partly, you know, the West is responsible for it. However, the legal codes didn't come from the West. That's not like you're by saying that, by just holding on to that one narrative, I'm completely discounting the responsibility that the people over there or the religion or the ideology that they follow has.
If you look at countries like, let's talk about this for a pause just briefly. Japan and Germany and South Korea, they were ruined by U.S. foreign policy. I mean, if you look at World War II, United States destroyed Germany. They actually did. I look at Germany right now. Look at Japan right now. I look at South Korea right now. This idea that, and back to the subject of responsibility, is that the difference is that many of the Muslim world believe that their software is the best software on earth. And they always try to shift the responsibility from themselves because they believe that it cannot be the problem of their ideology or the problem of their culture. And they always try to shift it to other people as they are responsible. I mean, I'm not going to give the United States and Israel a free pass. And I've been very critical of both of foreign policies of both of these countries. But I think that they have been used many times as a scapegoat in which, other than Muslims trying to say, you know what, let's build better schools, let's enhance the rights of women, let's give liberties to our people. No, it's America. It's Israel. It's always it's the best co-op response somebody can have. I grew up in Iraq. I mean, the Americans did not stop me from reading the books of Stephen Hawking. This idea that America and Israel is like conspiring together to try to stop Muslims from reaching Mars is kind of goes back to the conspiracy theories that really exist in the many minds of the Muslim world, is that they think that they have the best software and somehow all the world is conspiring to stop them from reaching the galaxies. And that's not, it's obviously false. It shifts the responsibility from them to us. And when people like C.J. Waterman and people like Noam Chomsky or Chris Hedges, and they all say it's all our fault and things like this, they are actually enhancing the mindset that many Muslims have. And that's why they have a lot of Muslim people who agree with them. They're like, yeah, hey, baby, it's their fault, not ours. No. We have the best software ever, and we have the last prophet, and it cannot be our fault. It has to be the fault of the Jews.
Yeah, I was actually, you know, someone that when you mentioned Noam Chomsky and how, you know, a lot of Muslims agree with him, I was thinking of something that somebody said to me. It's like, you know, when you criticize Islam, that it empowers all the anti-Muslim bigots. You know, they come out and, you know, you're giving them a voice. And I was reminded of the time when Osama bin Laden cited Noam Chomsky in one of his speeches to support his cause. Because Osama bin Laden and Noam Chomsky have, you know, very similar views on U.S. foreign policy. And that does not in any way invalidate Noam Chomsky's views. It doesn't mean that, you know, they're both sympathizers with each other. But, you know, sometimes they'll use that argument to shut you down. It's like, you know, what you're doing is the same thing that those anti-Muslim bigots say. But that does not mean that I'm them. That doesn't mean that, you know, they're me. So
there are things that, I mean, I think if the U.S. have done differently, I've written about this, about Iraq, it could have prevented ISIS from coming up. I mean, there are policies that the United States has enacted. Some things may have changed. But at the same time, Islam extremism as a concept and all of these actions, it's not a modern concept. I mean, we always talk about it as Islamic extremism as some sort of a Cold War. Because most people think that Islamic extremism means the Taliban or the institutionalized militias or it's called out-of-state factors. But if you look at the Ottoman Empire, if you look at previous empires that existed, they also had a lot of extreme views. And it's not that the Muslim world, like when people talk about the golden age of Islam, and it's not like they were Sweden back at the time and somehow Osama bin Laden came up and then they went back 1,000 years backward. I mean, these values of Islamic extremism and values of jihad and values of using violence to advance your ideology is not an old concept. The only things that we are now seeing, like we are focusing a lot of Islamic extremism and things like this, is because, first of all, we have different weaponry.
one person can do much more damage than before. And number two, we have better media and better. I mean, how did we know about Raif Badawi? It's because of social media. I mean, 40 years ago, Saudi Arabia also used to kill witches and kill people who disagree with them. Well, but we don't know because we don't have as much sharing of information as we do right now. So all of these things that we now call as Islamic extremism and the actions of gays getting killed and stuff used to happen all the time before. But the only difference is that now we have better media. We have better communication. Yeah. We have better internet.
And one more thing on the United States, you know, being blamed for everything. There is a damned if you do, damned if you don't type of thing. Like, you know, a lot of people say that if the Iraq war hadn't happened, then ISIS wouldn't be around today. But, you know, there's also another narrative. I mean, supposing that the Iraq war never happened, Saddam was still in power, the Arab Spring likely still would have happened. So the Arab Spring, the way that it started in Tunisia, to Libya, to Egypt, and then it would have started in Syria just like it did recently, right? Like with the whole thing spread to Syria. And it probably would have started in Iraq too. And if it came out in Iraq, then Saddam probably would have been less like Mubarak, but he would have been probably more like Assad. And he would have really, really clamped down on any kind of rebellion against him that came from the Arab Spring, if Saddam was alive. And, you know, that eventually would have resulted in ISIS as well. I mean, it could have resulted in ISIS. So to say that, you know, if this had happened, then this wouldn't have happened, isn't necessarily true. I mean, the U.S. didn't technically intervene in Syria as proactively as it did in, you know, in Iraq or in Libya, so on. But, you know, ISIS still arose from Syria. It didn't arise from Iraq. So we can't speculate. We can't go back in history and try to figure out what would have happened if this had changed or that changed, because there's so many different factors that actually go into it.
So the United States toppled down Saddam Hussein and the Sunni went to ISIS. It says more about Sunni Muslims than it says about the United States foreign policy. To be honest, if the only choices we have is Saddam Hussein or ISIS, it really says something extremely terrible about the people we're talking about. If that is the only choices that we have. Yeah.
It's very unfortunate, yeah.
Back to the extremism, if you look, there is a group called Ghawqa, which actually existed after the first Gulf War, in which like some of the Shias revolted against Saddam Hussein. And also Saddam used chemical weapons against them and things like this. And you will see many of them became as extreme as Al-Qaeda, who actually started fighting against Al-Qaeda after in the Civil War, who are now like called Jaish al-Mahdi and Munazamat Badr. And so even if the United States did not intervene, you'll see extremists all over.
I'll just remind you of the Barbary States back in 1786, when the Treaty of Tripoli, that actually says that the United States is in no way a Christian nation, actually came out of the result of a conflict with Islamist jihadists in Tripoli at the time, who were pirating Western ships in the Mediterranean. And when Thomas Jefferson went to negotiate with them, they told him exactly the same thing that the Taliban say today. They said that, you know, we can take these ships because you guys are infidels, and we're all going to go to heaven forever, and, you know, we can do this. And it was pretty much the same thing that ISIS and the Taliban and everything say. So, you know, this was before Saudi Arabia, this was before Israel, this was before the Taliban, Al-Qaeda, before anything. It was before the U.S. even had a foreign policy. The policy has always been the same when it comes to the Islamists. The jihad and all of that has always been the same. You know, it's not like there are no disenfranchised Buddhists or no disenfranchised or oppressed Christians or Jews in the world. I mean, there are everywhere, but, you know, it's not just the Muslims that are going through this. But throughout history, the jihad has always been engaged in. The excuse has been different, you know, and it has been continuing for quite a while. It has been going on for 1,400 centuries.
So the extremist with the machete who's sawing the heads off of people, the extremist who's gunning people down, you know, 125 children in a school, mm-hmm. dropping bombs. How does one approach them? Can they be reasoned with? Can they be talked out of their extremism? Or is lethal force the only way to handle this kind of threat? Or another solution?
I think you have to fight the ideology with ideology. There's some of them that are not going to change. I mean, these are extremists. They believe what they do to a delusional, fanatic extent. I mean, so you're not going to be able to stop what they think. But the one thing that we have to do is we have to make sure that it doesn't spread. You know, the people who already have the disease and you have to deal with them. I mean, a lot of times the military force, I mean, it's never a good thing to use military. I mean, I'm not a pacifist by any means, a complete pacifist, but it's never a good thing. I don't like the idea of using military force. But if you have somebody who's going to kill 20,000 people, and, you know, what you can do is you can prevent that by killing significantly less people, by preventing, you know, if you can prevent that, then unfortunately it's a choice between bad and worse. And when you have a choice between bad and worse, a lot of times you have to go with the bad, and the limitation of options in front of us right now. But the longer term, I think criticizing Islam, talking about it, you know, opening up to the idea of rejecting scriptural inerrancy, getting behind the right people instead of getting behind the moderates, getting behind the dissidents, the reformers, you know, the people who actually have serious, honest attitudes towards, you know, what they're trying to do, rather than the people who keep on trying to rationalize it. I mean, that's the only thing that we can do. And we should just keep on calling out bad ideas, you know, whether they're in the KKK manifesto or the Bible or the Quran or wherever they are, should be able to openly criticize them. And, you know, the one thing going back to Charlie Hebdo is that everyone is saying that, you know, the content was obscene, it was hate speech and so on. I mean, if we're going to have that conversation, I wrote this in the article too, if we're going to have that conversation about, you know, hate speech, then make it fair and open up the Quran and open up Islamic texts or open up, you know, the Bible or anything, all of these religious books, and, you know, scan them for hate speech. Make the competition even. Take the cartoons on one side and then take the stuff that says in scriptures about killing gay people, all the misogyny, endorsement of slavery, all of that. And, you know, put the insulted next to the insulting, compare them, and, you know, make it a fair game, and then talk about what hate speech is. I mean, if hate speech was a problem, if people really had a problem with hate speech, the Quran and the Bible would be the first to go.
First of all, I don't think we have a lot of time when it comes to Islamic extremism. The technology is advancing rapidly. And now, the only thing that is stopping ISIS from killing all of us right now is that they don't have the weapons to kill all of us.
Mm-hmm.
So I want all the audience to think about this. I mean, what really stopped Al-Qaeda from killing only 3,000 people at New York City is not that if they didn't have a problem with killing 3,000, they wouldn't have a problem with killing 3 million or 300 million. The only thing that is stopping them is access to nuclear weaponry and access to advanced weaponry that kill as many amount of people as possible. We're living in a very crazy world, if you think about it. I mean, if you look at countries like Pakistan, which has the nuclear bombs, and it's kind of a failed state in which the government is controlling some areas and the Taliban is controlling some areas and things like this, and in which the ISI is allied with the Taliban, it makes me worried that one day we're going to wake up and we'll see that there are 300 to 400 million people killed because the Taliban took control of the nuclear weapons. So I don't think we really have, like, people talk about the Christian Reformation took 400 years. Let's wait another 400 years for Islam to reform. I don't think we actually have 400 years before all the world's going to be blown up by extremists. And I think that extremism is growing in a lot of parts of the world. Some parts of the world are going advanced, but some parts are not.
So should we be posting illustrations, yes, caricatures of the Prophet? Should we be putting Muhammad on our social media pages? And
I think that just having an honest conversation and talking about that we do have a problem within the Muslim world and beliefs have consequences, and we have to have honest conversation about them. And I think that when it comes to the cartoons or things like this, I think the best response should have been when the attacks happened would be, we should publish more cartoons, not less cartoons, even though I'm not really a fan of cartoons anyway. But we only have two choices, I think, is that we either surrender to terrorists or we either defeat them. I think that the war was imposed on us, not that we started the war. We really have to go on the offensive and try to stop terrorism from destroying one of the most precious values, which is freedom of speech.
Ali, I'll give you the last word here.
Yeah, I was, again, you know, the freedom of speech, everybody talks about the difference between, like, you know, is freedom of speech the same thing as freedom to offend? And I think that there's no point to freedom of speech without the freedom to offend. That's the whole reason it's protected so strongly. And I wondered, that was, you know, the movie The Interview, you know, with the made fun of Kim Jong-un, you know, that really pissed off the North Korean regime. you know, as we saw. And I think that shows how important mockery is. I mean, the one thing that they really want, Kim Jong-un really wants, that ISIS really wants, that all of these like sort of fanatics want, is that they want to be taken seriously. So when you have all of these like, you know, serious, incisive, critiques and op-eds of, you know, their policies and things like that in newspapers, you know, it makes them feel legitimate, makes them feel equal on the world stage with everybody else. But when you reduce the regime, the North Korean regime, down to, you know, a bunch of dick jokes in a goofball Seth Rogen comedy, which was fantastic, by the way, when you do that, that shows them that you're not taking them seriously. And that is the one thing that they hate. They really want to be taken seriously. And the moment you mock them and they get any sense that you're not taking them seriously, they'd go nuts. And I've seen this with a lot of Islamic clerics or, you know, even any kind of like really, really religious person. They're always out there, you know, looking like they're in a Captain America uniform with some crazy hat and long ass beard and, you know, all this stuff. And they just look like clowns. And occasionally, once in a while, you know, if you look like a clown, if you're acting like one, if you're a grown, educated man who's in his, late 70s and you're talking about angels and jinns and, you know, all these winged horses and talking snakes and things like that, if you're doing that, then, you know, we should mock them. They absolutely, like, you know, those are ridiculous things to believe for somebody of that age. And in this time, in 2015, and reasonably educated, literate people were, you know, believing this, they should be mocked. But just the fact that they're taken seriously all the time, and you have to pretend like you actually respect their beliefs when you talk to them, you know, make it seem like it's an actual debate, that gives them legitimacy. And we've seen that it works when we don't give them that. And we should continue not giving them that.
Ali Rizvi and Faisal Saeed Al-Muttar, thank you so much for spending the hour, the last hour of the broadcast, and giving us your perspective on a very complex and compelling issue. I will include in the description box of this broadcast links to both of these gentlemen and their work and a way to follow what they do online. And of course, they do, I believe, speak around the country as well. For your time and for your perspective tonight, greatly appreciate it. Thank you so much.
God bless.
Thanks, Seth.
Exactly.
I wanted to close the broadcast with something that I had written in the wake of Charlie Hebdo. We were part of an online discussion about the response to, you know, the tragedy and how we should approach the issue, especially with Islam, the word Islam hanging overhead. I like the way I said it the first time. I thought it might be a good way to sort of cap the evening. My word said this: the challenge seems overwhelming. In a soundbite culture, it is easy to become frustrated at the Go America crowd and its often blind nationalism. The United States has been a force for good in the world. And the United States has been a force for destruction, greed, ineptitude, and chaos. For every fight which has been necessary and justified, there are others that were driven by idealism, political maneuvering, and a quest to control resources. We fought terrorists. We funded terrorists. It's a mess. The incredible nuance of this situation does not lend itself to the often binary thinking of the Fox News crowd, a group of spoon-fed sheeple who know more about cruise movies than cruise missiles. I saw a funny sign recently that said, "To err is human. To really fuck up requires Republicans." You can take that or leave it. Conversely, Islam and radical Islamic nations can't be given a pass simply because many choose to ignore the most unpleasant parts of their holy book. Fundamentalists are carrying out the will of Allah, and those who charge that Islam means peace have been misinformed. Islam means submission, as in complete submission to Allah, and the peace refers to a world that has been converted and or conquered in Allah's name. Now, do the beheaders and the executioners of children get a pass under any circumstances, especially as they shout, "God is great"? And can we ignore the role that religion has played in their actions? Is the USA truly to blame for the constant circus of blood and pain perpetrated in the name of Islam? Recently, a Saudi Arabian blogger, Reef Badawi, was sentenced to 1,000 lashings carried out over 20 weeks for the heinous crime of hosting a website called Free Saudi Liberals. His lawyer got 15 years in prison for daring to, quote-unquote, insult the courts. This is an Islamic court representing the Islamic religion, a thin-skinned male power fantasy so threatened by an idea that it would lash human flesh over the expression of it. And don't get me started on fundamentalist Islam's reputation on the issue of women's rights. Muslim cleric Anhem Shadari told USA Today the truth, quote, Muslims do not believe in the concept of freedom of expression. And to a degree, casual, cultural Muslims bear a measure of responsibility of policing their own religion from within. And they, like cultural Christians, don't get the luxury of distancing themselves from the nastier parts of their scriptures. Ultimately, my point is this. We should avoid at all costs the knee-jerk tendency to speak about these monumentally complicated issues in bumper stickers, but instead must understand that the underlying problems have much to do with blind faith. Faith in gods, faith in governments, and the natural tendency of governing bodies, religious or otherwise, to oppress and silence dissenting voices. We need a new era of enlightenment, and I am not convinced that enlightenment will be found in any dogma, especially those of fundamental Islam. Thank you so much for listening to the broadcast tonight. Thanks to all of my very special guests, and thanks to our sponsor, Evolve Fish. .com, promoting free speech through a variety of very, very cool products you can see online right now. EvolveFish.com, and I will see you next week on the Thinking Atheist radio podcast.
Follow the Thinking Atheist on Facebook and Twitter. Watch dozens of original videos on the Thinking Atheist YouTube channel. And visit our website for resources, links, contact information, the editor's blog, and more. TheThinkingAtheist.com.